guys, welcome back. It's Josh with the Financial Advisor Car Guy. So I wanted to film this video in the evening because I wanted you guys to see what I see through these garage doors. And it's pretty dark. What you see is actually the reflection of my Audi from right over here. And I mean, I can't see out. I have to walk up to the glass and kind of like look out and see what I see. But if you're outside looking in and I have the lights on, it's like plain as day. So someone could be out there watching me right now, and I really don't think that there is, but in theory, they'd be able to watch me film this and they'd probably wonder what the heck I'm doing talking to myself. So weird. But that's not what we're gonna talk about this week. I just wanted to show you guys that. This week's topic is actually completely off the cuff. I know we've done a lot of episodes about, I will use the term side hustle for the lack of a better term, but basically different hobbies that you can utilize to make a little extra income, right? And you know, I've shared with you guys, cars are a big passion of my life. I love to buy cars, fix them up, flip them, and then move on to the next project. You guys have seen me do that a few times, and you've heard stories of other times when I've done it too. And so, you know, I mean, on this channel, we've had the Challenger, we've had the Hummer, we've had the Eclipse. Now that's not getting flipped, but you've got to watch the progress there. You've seen bits and pieces about the Mustang. You've seen actually episode 3, 4, 5, something like that. You guys saw the 65 Mustang that I had built that got shipped off to Paris, France. We've done a few cars on the channel, and there's going to be more to come. I mean, ultimately, someday there will be another car that we'll work through together, but that's just one of several, right? A couple of my other hobbies, you know, I really love watches, and I really love sports cards. And I know I did an episode, and I didn't even think to go look before filming this, but realistically, I did one. It was probably episode 12, maybe in the teens even. But it was literally about my return on investment on a couple of Mickey Mantle cards that I bought. And I wanted to kind of preface the story with that because realistically, sports cards are something that not everybody's into, but true collectors, true connoisseurs of the sport, true connoisseurs of the industry will go out of their way to pay top dollar for a really great card, maybe a professionally graded card. And I mean, there's comps, we use eBay, you know, those kind of things. But truth be told, if I have a card that doesn't sell often and it's a desirable player or a desirable whatever it is, it kind of, the market is dictated by the supply and the demand. And so cards that are numbered one of one anymore aren't as rare as they used to be because nowadays there's one of ones for like every player. Which sort of defeats the purpose, but the point is, if some generic player is my favorite player and I really want to own this one of one, there's not really a comp out there for it. I can't just Google what's this card worth or what should I pay for this card because there's only one of them, right? It's truly a supply and demand thing. Now, I have several one of ones in my collection, mostly all Giants players. I'm a Giants fan. I'm sure you've seen on the channel me in a Giants t-shirt or a Giants hoodie or a Giants ball cap. I'm a Giants fan. I'm from the Bay Area originally, so to me, that was my team growing up. There's a lot more to that story, but truth be told, that's my team. And so I collect cards, but not super. I've gotten more into it recently because of my son. He and I have started buying packs at Walmart and at other little stores and shops and things, and we're piecing together sets and collecting certain players. And the purpose of today's episode is sports cards in general, but I'm gonna share with you kind of my and my son's little side hustle right now. And it's actually been a lot of fun. So there are several platforms on the internet, and I'm not gonna tell you which one I use because I'm not being sponsored. I don't feel like that's fair because I haven't used them all. So I don't wanna say I've used this one because it's the best. But yeah, I'm not a sponsored YouTuber, so this is just my personal opinion, but really I use a website or I use an app that I can literally open a pack of cards, take a picture of a card, it scans it into kind of a database, it tells me the approximate value, it tells me how many are listed for sale currently on both this platform and on eBay, And then it tells me the average sale price between the two listing places. So for example, I buy a pack of cards and I open it and I get a Mike Trout, or a Shohei Ohtani is probably a better example. So a Shohei Ohtani, and let's say that the average sale price is $20, and maybe there's a few sales, because I can look at historical sales through this app, and maybe they've sold for 15, 18, 20, 22, 26, and 30, something like that. But when you average it out, it's right around $20. So I can look at the dates. I can say, well, it looks like the trend is that it's been going down in price. You know, the most recent sale was $18, but 3 months ago, it would have been $30. Or vice versa. Maybe 3 months ago, it was $18. And now that we're getting into baseball season, maybe now it's $25 or $30 card. So I can literally open the pack, take a picture of the card, list it right then and there into this database app, and it assigns it an approximate value, but then I can also hit the like list for trade, list for sale, and it will publicly put it on this website for sale. So anybody who goes to this through this app and searches Shohei Ohtani will find a list of all the Shohei cards that are for sale. And if they find mine, they like my price, maybe I'm a dollar less than the next guy, I can make a sale. They not only pay for the card, but they pay for shipping and all that stuff. And this particular company takes 10%. That's the commission fee that I pay, is 10%. So if I sell a $30 card, they take $3 and I get 27. I don't worry about shipping. Literally the buyer pays shipping, and all I have to do is print out a prepaid shipping label. So it's super easy, super straightforward. My son and I are loving it. I've only been doing it for about a month, and now I'm not getting rich or anything, but I've sold a couple, a couple dozen orders north of $100. So, I mean, again, not getting rich on it, but the momentum is building. I sold two cards yesterday. I sold one the day before, and that was after like 2 or 3 days of no activity. And so the cool thing is as people view your collection, is what they call it, right? It is a collection. As they view it, they can follow you and they can then, you know, share your cards and like your cards and comment on your cards and do all these things. And it's a platform for multiple sports and non-sports cards. So there are some Pokemon cards and a couple other alternative cards. And then there's, of course, baseball, basketball, football, hockey, all the other sports. And so it's pretty neat that way, because I can, whatever season it is, right? Like right now, baseball cards are selling. And so they're in season, but not too far from now, right? Football will start, and then basketball, and they're all kind of overlapping, but you can literally time your postings with whatever season it is, which is awesome. So, you know, a lot of basketball cards are still selling right now. And then of course, baseball, but I digress. The purpose of today was just kind of talk to you guys about this particular side hustle. And again, it's a no-brainer. You know, I mean, if you're going to collect cards anyway, or if you're going to collect anything, right, there's probably means to recoup some of your investment. If I go to Walmart and I buy we'll call it a $20 box of cards, it might have a few packs in it, whatever it is, I can literally come home. My son and I can sit down, we can open all these packs. I can take one or two or three or four cards or whatever. If they're not going to be part of my set or my collection, literally I can take a quick picture, put it in a sleeve, top loader, you know, in a case essentially, right? And then put it in a box and it's listed for sale. Now I have three boxes. I have, I don't know, 925 cards or something listed. And it gives a running value of what the value of your collection for sale is. And so these 900 cards are worth something like $6,000, something like that. And so the average card is less than $10. It's, you know, it's maybe a little bit more than $7, something like that. But conceptually, I've got cards on there that are $30, $40, $50. And then I have a bunch of cards that are 25 cents, $1, $1.50, right, whatever it is. And so average wise, you know, again, something 5,500 to 6,000 bucks for my 900 and whatever cards. And again, as people buy them, it's great because it gives me, you know, a little bit of cash flow that I can go buy a new pack and kind of start the process again. And so it's kind of a fun way to recycle these cards, because when I was a kid, I collected cards. I had a baseball card shop that was down the street from my house, literally, you know, a 5-minute walk. And I spent a lot of time in there, every weekend. In fact, I would go in there, and they used to do this deal with kids like 13 and under, I think it was, where you could pay like $5 and they'd give you a, you know, a card table or whatever, a small table, and you could put out all your cards and stuff, and you could trade with people, you could sell them, you could do whatever you wanted with your little space. And all they did was take like $5. And so I remember from a very young age doing this, right? I would corral all my cards, and I'd put them in cases, and I'd set them out all over this table. And, you know, every once in a while you'd sell one to your friend or whatever it was. And instead of trading, I would sell them. And let's say I sold, you know, 5 cards at $1 a piece. At the end of the day, I'd take my $5 and I'd go right up to the counter and I'd buy a pack or two or three or whatever it was of cards. And so it was kind of my way of keeping my collection a little bit more fresh. I'd sell stuff off and then rebuy packs, you know, whatever the current set is, and hope for the chase cards and all the things. Today, it's not different, but the means of it is a lot different, because realistically, sports card shops are not as common. They're not as everywhere as they once upon a time were. So we do resort to the eBays and these apps to sell and to buy in a lot of cases too, because if I want to chase one particular player or I'm looking for one particular card, I can't just go buy packs until I get that card or that player, because especially, like I said, if we're chasing a one of one or a one of five or a one of 10, you know, I might have to open $1,000 worth of packs and still not get it. Or I could just go to eBay and buy the card for $100 or whatever it is too. So, I mean, there's a lot of that where, is it a better investment to chase through packs or to just buy the cards you want? And different collectors will tell you different things. There's online communities. I'm on a couple of Facebook groups. One of my favorites, and I will plug this because I think it's just hilarious, is called Sports Card Nonsense. And that's what it is, right? People share the most nonsensical stories about sports cards. They'll open a pack and find some obscure something or other. So they take a picture and post it, and people just roast each other. It's hilarious. It's really, really funny. And it's on Facebook. And so it's a public site, you know, or a public group. There's like 200 and some odd thousand members. It's a huge group. And I actually stumbled upon it on accident because I was just on Facebook one day and it was a suggested page. It wasn't, none of my friends had joined it. It was just totally suggested. And it showed a Ken Griffey Jr. card or something like that that caught my eye because I'm a Jr. fan. And so I click on it and I'm reading some of the, and it's funny banter back and forth. And some people are making fun of the guy for asking the question he asked. And other people are like, oh, I really want that card. You're awesome. Whatever. And so, yeah, I digress again. It's just, it is what it is. It's a fun hobby for someone who's got some interest in it. If you know the players, if you like the game, if you like the sport. And it's nostalgic for me because I did it when I was my son's age. And so getting him into it, getting him excited, super fun. Super duper fun. And so trying to recoup some money on the deal is kind of my justification for doing it. I don't have room in my house to just store boxes and boxes of sports cards. I have a lot of my cards from when I was my son's age, and I've stored them all these years. And you know, what you'll find is cards from the 80s and 90s were so mass produced, they're essentially worthless. I mean, you couldn't give them away in a lot of cases. And that actually is gonna be my segue to next week. I'm gonna tell you guys a story next week of a sports card transaction that dealt with car parts. I attempted to do a trade and it went sideways. And so we're gonna talk about that. That's gonna be next episode. That's gonna be next week. But that's all I got for you guys this week. If you guys have questions, concerns, comment down below, like, subscribe. Do you guys collect cards? I would love to grow my network of card collecting friends. So hit me up. Let me know if you guys want to trade, you know, whatever it is. If you are looking for an online marketplace to sell your collection, much like I've described, message me. I'm happy to tell you what platform I use. Again, I didn't want to put it in the video because I haven't tried them all. I don't know. I only know the one that I'm using. And for full disclosure, I did pay for the premium account because with the basic account, you can only post something like 500 cards. I didn't know that until I started listing. And then all of a sudden I'm like 300 cards in and realized, crap, I'm like a third of the way or less through my cards that I want to list. I'm gonna have to do something more. And so what I ended up doing was just did the basic until I sold $50 worth of cards. Then basically that first $50 of profit I made, or not profit, but sales I made, I took that 50 and paid for the membership. So now the rest of it's all been since buying the premium pro package or whatever they call it. So, but I'm having a fun time with it. It's been an interesting, fun hobby for my son and I again. And we're spending time communicating differently, right? We're talking about who's the hot player we're chasing in these packs, who's team's gonna take it all the way, right? You know, where should we run and see if they have packs in stock? And because most places don't, right? It's just the way it is. There's a craze going on right now, and it's a fun thing to be a part of. And anyway, thanks for watching. Take care. May every investment you make be a good one. Till next time.